Good evening and welcome, everyone. Good afternoon to those who are joining us from the West Coast. My name is Michelle Kaiser, and I am a diplomat in residence with the U.S. Department of State, covering the states of New England. I'm honored to be with you here this evening to present to you a second panel in our series featuring distinguished women here at the Department of State. This evening, we'll hear from three distinguished leaders here at the Department of State about their careers and their experiences being female leaders. Before we begin, I want to share a couple housekeeping items with you. We are recording this session for future reference, so if anyone does not want their face recorded, please just turn off your cameras now. For those who don't mind, we're happy to see your faces. We also ask that everyone mute their microphones for the extent of this panel and for the discussion so that we can hear everyone very clearly. Feel free throughout the panel to drop questions in the chat. We will be monitoring those and trying to respond to them as quickly as we can. And we'll also put information in the panel channel as well. And so if you have questions, you can drop them in the chat, or we will do a Q&A at the end of the session as well. And we thank everyone for your patience with your questions. We want to receive them. So with that, I want to introduce my colleague, another diplomat in residence covering the great state of New York. She's very busy, very active. With that, I'll turn it over to Kyla. Thank you for being here.
Thank you, Michelle, and thank you for being our chat moderator extraordinaire. I also, before we start, I just want to say that we also have Josie Williams, who's our national recruiter, who helped us put this on, and to thank all the other DIRs who are helping us moderate the chat. I'm really honored to have the chance to moderate this distinguished panel of women leaders at the State Department. So I think to start, I'm going to read their bios so you know who you're talking to, and then we're going to jump straight into questions. And as Michelle said, we're going to leave some time at the end in order for you to ask some questions that you have as well. Okay, so first, I just want to introduce Deputy Chief of Mission Stephanie Siptek-Rumnath. She's currently the DCM at our Embassy of the U.S. of America in New Mexico City. She's a career member of the Senior Foreign Service, and she most recently served as Deputy Executive Secretary in the Office of the Secretary of State, where she was responsible for internal coordination of the work of the department, serving as the liaison between six geographic and functional bureaus and the offices of the Secretary, Deputy Secretary, and Undersecretaries. She led the department's 24-hour operations center that monitors global events, the secretary and other department principals, facilitates communication between the department and the rest of the world, and coordinates the department's response to crises. Stephanie served as chargé d'affaires at our U.S. Embassy Singapore from January 2017 to July 2019, where she directed 19 U.S. government sections and agencies in the advancement of bilateral security, military, economic, and people-to-people cooperation. During that time, she led embassy efforts in support of the historic June 2018 Singapore summit between President Trump and Chairman Kim. She previously served as Minister Counselor for Public Diplomacy at U.S. Embassy Mexico City, Deputy Chief of Mission in Bamako, Mali, and Senior Deputy Director in the Office of Public Diplomacy in the Bureau of European and Eurasian Affairs. Other assignments include Tunisia, the U.S. Mission to the United Nations, and Monterrey, Mexico. In November 2015, Stephanie was awarded the Department of State's Edward R. Murrow Award for Excellence in Public Diplomacy. And prior to joining the Foreign Service, Stephanie was an officer in the U.S. Navy. She was also a member of the International Women's Forum Leadership Foundation, the 2011-2012 Fellows Class, and she's a graduate of Georgetown University's School of Foreign Service. She's married and has two daughters that are currently studying at Northwestern University and Pepperdine University. So welcome, DCM. I also want to move on to introduce Consul General Anna Escrohima. She is currently our Consul General at the U.S. Consulate in Montreal. She is a 19-year veteran of the Foreign Service. She served as the Office Director for Regional and Multilateral Affairs in the Near Eastern Affairs Bureau. She serves overseas as the Deputy Chief of Mission in the Yemen Affairs Unit in Saudi Arabia, where she established in 2015 after the closure of the U.S. Embassy in Yemen. A former RUSC Fellow at Georgetown's Institute for the Study of Diplomacy, Anna has extensive experience abroad and in Washington, D.C. She was the State Department's UAE-based Arabic language spokesperson and served as the public affairs officer in Algeria, where she was responsible for all bilateral cultural and press engagements. Anna served as a political officer at the U.S. embassies in Iraq and Syria. She was a special assistant to former Undersecretary of State for Political Affairs Wendy Sherman, with responsibility for Middle East issues and most notably the Iran nuclear negotiations. Anna was also a diplomat in residence for the New York metro area, so the job that I currently have, where she focused on reaching diverse audiences with the department's recruitment pitch and taught a course on U.S. diplomacy in the Middle East. She's the recipient of numerous State Department Superior Meritorious Honor Awards. And in 2020, Anna was awarded the Arnold L. Raphael Memorial Award in recognition of work promoting diversity at the State Department, which includes recruiting underrepresented groups, supporting entry-level employees, and advocating for institutional change. Originally from New York, Anna graduated from Brown University as a Thomas R. Pickering Foreign Affairs Fellow with a BA in International Relations and Affairs and French, and holds a master's degree from Columbia's School of International and Public Affairs. So welcome, Consul General Escrohima. Okay, and now I also have the honor to introduce Deputy Assistant Secretary for Passport Services in our Bureau of Consular Affairs, Rachel Arndt, who oversees and directs the network of passport agencies and centers that are responsible for the acceptance, adjudication, and issuance of U.S. passports, the passport and vital records filing and retrieval systems, and the department's authentication function. Ms. Arndt was previously served as the Comptroller in the Bureau of Consular Affairs, the Director of Planning and Program Support in Passport Services, Bureau of Consular Affairs, and Senior Management and Program Analyst in the Office of Management Policy, Rightsizing, and Innovation. She's also served as Financial Plan Manager for the State Operations Budget, as a Budget Analyst in the Bureau of Population, Refugees, and Migration, as well as the Bureau of Oceans, Environment, and Science, and as a Management Consultant in the Department's Information Technology Capital Planning Office. Ms. Arndt has an MA from George Mason University and a BA from the University of Wisconsin Madison. She is married and she has three children. So welcome, Das Arndt. Okay, wonderful. So as you can see, we have a very distinguished panel. You've just heard their entire background, and maybe that's going to get you thinking about a question to ask them, because you can just see from that there's a lot of experience to draw from. But let's just jump right into it. Since you're all such accomplished women, can you each tell me what inspired you to bring your many talents to the Department of State? And I think just to make it easier, we'll start with CG Escrohima.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for that introduction. And then I also just wanted to say Ramadan Kareem for everyone who is celebrating. I would say that I came into the State Department as a career through actually the Pickering Fellowship. I was 19 years old when I discovered and applied for it. I was looking for opportunities for students interested in international affairs, and there wasn't, which I think was a good thing for me, as much copious information out there online about options for careers in general, or, you know, actually careers at state for that matter, or even through my university career center. So when this fellowship came up, it sounded like such an amazing opportunity and a gateway into a career that I hadn't yet considered. And of course, back then, back in the day, it was a smaller and less well-known program. I believe we were six in my undergrad cohort. And, you know, so I entered through that fellowship, of course, having had an interest in international affairs. I remember, you know, donning a suit and coming to Washington, D.C. for the whole interview process and finding that so intimidating. But winning the fellowship, attending grad school where I studied Arabic, you know, serving as an intern in NEA, both domestically and overseas, sort of oriented me toward a passion for the Middle East and its issues, which has sort of been the pathway, the career pathway I've taken. So that's it.
Thank you. Very inspiring. Can I turn to Dicia and Siptak Ramna?
Sure. So mine is kind of a funny story because I was a senior in high school and I told my mom, I want to be an airline stewardess, which is, I don't even think that's what you call them anymore, but that I just wanted to see the world and meet interesting people. And so then my mom said, no, you're going to go to college. So then I looked at different universities and I found Georgetown and I ended up at Georgetown University School of Foreign Service, but I was there on a Navy ROTC scholarship. So, you know, for those of you who don't know that, they pay for your university, but then you owe 4 years of active duty service. So I was a senior and my mom, you will see, my mom is a very big influence on my life. I don't know how many other women in the room feel the same way. But my mom said, well, you have to take the Foreign Service exam. And I said, no, I don't, because I'm going into the Navy. And she said, you cannot graduate from the School of Foreign Service and not take the Foreign Service exam. So I said, well, okay. And so I took the Foreign Service exam my senior year, and I don't know how I did, but I passed it. And then they put me for 4 years. They didn't place me on the registry because I was in active duty military service. And then you think the State Department forgets you, but they don't. I was actually going to law school at night. I was all set to be a JAG. And then I get the call. Your 4 years are up. Would you like to join the Foreign Service? And so then I thought, well, I can go back to law school and I can join the Navy again, but they're probably not going to call me again for the Foreign Service. So that was now 27 years ago. So that's how I ended up in the Foreign Service. The moral of the story is listen to your mom.
I was going to say, we should thank your mom because we're on the other side and we're the lucky recipients of her advice. That's wonderful. Thank you for sharing. Des Arndt, can I turn to you?
Yes. Hi, everyone. Yeah, it's very inspirational listening to you ladies. I'm really enjoying this myself. So I was, I followed my husband out here to the East Coast and I was working in the private sector. And I guess I listened to my parents or followed their example because I said I wanted to do good. I don't know if that's good English, but I wanted to do good. And so I said, well, you know, I'm out here in DC. Let me look at the federal government. And I started applying for positions. And I actually got my first position at the Department of Agriculture. And I said, well, that's okay. I can always move over to the State Department. And so 2 years after that, I was very lucky to get a position at the State Department. And it was a budget analyst position. And it was a GS, I started, I was a GS-5 budget analyst. So for me to have been in the senior executive service for 10 years now, I just, you know, I had a wonderful career. But, you know, I studied international relations and economics. And so if you think about it, economics is the allocation of scarce resources. So a budget analyst allocating resources at the State Department in an international environment had my, if only my advisor had known about those positions. And I think that's one of the things for this universities out there. I like to travel, but I don't like to move necessarily. So, you know, being in the civil service at the State Department is a way to be involved in the international arena. And there are just so many positions here in the civil service. I often liken it to a small town where there's just every kind of job imaginable here. But yes, I guess in the end, I did pay attention to my parents and the upbringing that I had as far as helping others and service to others.
Thank you all. I'm seeing a theme here. One is listen to your parents. Two is that your career can take different zigs and zags before you end up with the State Department. There's a lot of ways to enter. And three is that we have lots of career tracks. As you can see, we have the Foreign Service Specialist, and then also our Civil Service. So I'm glad you mentioned that as well. Okay, I also want to ask all of you another question, because this year's theme for Women's History Month is Embrace Equity. So in your words, can you tell us what that means to you personally? And this time, I think I'll start with DCM SIPTEC.
So that's a very good question. I feel like I'm in front of Congress. That's a very good question. I think for me, equity, it just means so much. It encompasses so many things that this is the way I try to manage it here at Mission Mexico, where we have 39 government agencies, 3,300 people, 9 consulates, 9 consular agencies. So this is an enormous platform. And we're so blessed to have so many people working for us. So to me, I always look at all the issues of diversity, equity, inclusion, and accessibility as just basic levels of respect, of giving people the respect that they deserve for being part of our team, for having been chosen. And I want to get into the idea of being chosen. That everybody who works on this team was chosen to be on this team, and they were chosen because they have skills and personalities and just abilities that make us better. So to me, equity is making sure that everybody feels that respect and that they were chosen to be here with us. And so that means that we are all here trying to be amazing every single day, whether it's for Mexico or the United States. So equity to me is making sure that everybody feels that way and then has the ability to be as amazing as I know everybody wakes up wanting to be every day, and making sure that everybody has the resources and the support and the respect and just the positive environment to be amazing. So that's my view. It's probably not the correct clinical definition of equity, but that's how I look at it.
Thank you. I think those words are very important for people to hear on this call. Can I turn to Das Arndt?
Yeah, sure, that's great. I love that ability to be amazing. I wrote that down because I think that's just a wonderful way to phrase it. And so what it is, you know, for me, we're all unique. We all have different backgrounds. We come from different places, and we're interested in different things, and we approach things very differently. And I also in charge of a very large organization too, you know, with the Cross Passport Services. We're across the United States in 29 different locations, very different regions. And I say they all have a personality of the agencies. And so, you know, we're looking at the folks who are coming in at each of those agencies, and how do we bring in a diverse set of people? How do we best utilize their current skill sets? How do we help them develop the skill sets that they need? I guess what you said, to be amazing, right? So, you know, and what's really great about being a senior leader is we can provide that direction and discuss with our staff how best to make sure that we're bringing the best out of everybody and that each individual can reach their potential and the goals that they have set for themselves. And so, you know, we get to say things to people like, when you have a hiring panel, we want to have a diverse hiring panel so that we can make sure that we have a good look at across the board at who we're bringing in, and that it's not just cookie cutter and everybody is like everybody else. You know, or here at headquarters, I might make sure that I'm looking around and bringing in junior staff to meetings so that they can present to principals and have those opportunities so that they can learn and grow. I would also say I try to meet with every one of my GS 14 and 15s and 2s and 1s across the country. And so that's about one a day I can get, and I can't quite get through everybody in a year, but that way I have an ability to have a conversation with them and find out more about them and what they're working on and what's working, what's not working, and how we can help them succeed. So that's really, that's probably the best meeting to go to in any given day. And I learn a lot from a lot of people, but I would just go back to we're all unique, we're all different, but how do we help everybody succeed with what they're bringing to the table?
Thank you. I think both those points are important, bringing diversity and hiring, and also how do we help people succeed? And then CJ Escrohima, I wanted to save you for last because I did mention during your bio that you were awarded the Arnold L. Raphael Memorial Award for promoting diversity in the State Department. So I'm going to turn this over to you.
Well, I agree with everything Rachel and Stephanie said. I would say, maybe I want to talk a little bit about the embrace piece and thinking about how as leaders, you know, diversity work, diversity and inclusion work sort of starts at the top, and this idea of leadership authentically embracing that work and thinking about it and how to move it forward every day. Whether that's in the words we use or the things that we choose to focus on, either internally or with our external audiences, the ways that we get our teams excited about taking on this work as well. You know, I think we're such a process-oriented organization, it could be really easy for, you know, it to sort of seem performative in a way, but just really embracing it. And I read an article that talked about, you know, DIA being the need for it to become a movement versus a mandate to really shift the culture of an organization in that direction. So if I would add anything, I think I like the embrace piece of that. And I think it's critical to leadership in that space as well. And I also, I don't want to embarrass Stephanie, but I would say in the Western Hemisphere affairs land, Mission Mexico is a model. And as someone who tries to work on DIA and at our consulate in Montreal, I always look at the cables Mission Mexico puts out. and you've done some just really, really stellar work on that front. So kudos to you and the team, Stephanie.
Thank you for actually calling out Stephanie on that, because I think it's important that we, you know, support each other in these efforts that are successful. And it was great to hear all of you talk about embracing equity, embracing diversity, and then, you know, also the words you're using and how you do that. I think those are all great takeaways. I want to turn now to asking you each kind of individual questions based on your backgrounds. The DCM SIPTech Ramnath, I know we know women are in leading roles in business and organizations, and that a diversity of voices are important, as we've just heard all of you expound on. But as a woman who served in leadership roles across the State Department and also had a career in the Navy before joining the department, can you share how your previous career and training prepared you to have a successful career in the State Department? And then, I guess, going off of what you said earlier, what skills women should develop as they look to take on more leadership roles?
Thanks. So again, I always have to go back to my mom. Anyone who ever hears me talk about my mom, right? So I think it was the idea that my mom gave me that then went through the Navy and then here. So I have about 31 years of government service, but my mom always raised me. She always said, "Can't is for dead people." In other words, if you want to do it, just get up and do it. And that if you're gonna do something, do it well, right? This got to be like, if you wake up, make your bed, right? If you take off your shirt, fold it. There. So that was kind of, my mom's from Singapore, if anybody knows anything about Singapore. So that was kind of how we were raised, with just this idea that bring your best to the world and expect the best from the world. And the other thing that she really taught me was that you know who you are. It doesn't really matter what everybody else thinks. You just focus on yourself and being your very best. So fast forward into what I've learned in the Navy and what I learned in the Foreign Service and what I'd love to share. I'm so glad there's so many students on. Please join the State Department, whether you're civil service, foreign service, generalist, specialist. This is the most amazing career, and I love our dips and residents for doing this. But I'd say there are five things that I would recommend to people. So the first is kind of what I said before, is know that you are chosen. Wherever you are in your career, or wherever you are in the State Department, or wherever you have been chosen to be there. Nobody just walked out in the street into a classroom. Nobody just walked out in the street into the State Department or into an embassy. You applied and you were chosen. And you were chosen because people felt like you had the skills to be amazing at what you were doing. So every day, wake up knowing that you were chosen and that you are recognized for being the right person to be a great part of whatever you are a part of, whether it's a university or an embassy or a State Department. And I think that's very important, because when you can bring that to your work, then you have an inner sense of self-confidence that even if you don't know anything, everything, you know that you belong there at the table, you belong there at the desk, and that you have been chosen to do something great there. So the first thing is understanding you were chosen. The second is just be so curious, because none of us know everything, right? And every day there's so much to learn. And just wake up every day and be curious. I think that has helped me in my career. And I think that helps people around who I've seen be successful, is they're just naturally curious. The third thing is humility. Because we don't know everything, it's okay to admit you don't know everything. Every single day, I ask questions, somebody says something, I'm like, I have no idea what that is. And it's okay to say that because you have all the skills you're bringing to the table. You may not have every piece of information, but the more curious you are and the more willing you are to say, hey, I don't know that, and be interested in what other people are bringing to the table, I think that helps for success. The fourth thing is be passionate about what you're doing. Just wake up every morning and love it, right? And if you're not waking up every morning, I mean, we all go through dry spells, right? But if you're not inspired by what you're doing, see what else it is that might inspire you. I love being a Foreign Service Officer. I think every one of us who are in this job at the State Department are blessed to be.
Okay, so I was actually jotting down her five things because I think these are wonderful, wonderful tidbits, but I see that she's frozen for a second. So while hopefully she's coming back, because I do want to hear number five, I am going to go ahead and jump to another question, if that's okay with everyone, and then we'll come back to talk with the DCM. So Consul General Escrohima, you mentioned earlier that you were selected for the prestigious Pickering Fellowship. And we know as DIRs that a number of current State Department employees have taken advantage of our student programs and that they're often an excellent path to a career as a Foreign Service Officer. Can you kind of share how you navigated that application process and maybe how the fellowship impacted your career path and the journey to where you are now?
Sure. Well, I think I mentioned sort of how intimidating I found, you know, flying to Washington, D.C. for the first time and sort of, you know, all of the aspects of the written and oral parts of the fellowship. I mean, I think now there's so much more information online available about the process. So I would encourage folks to, take advantage of that, you know, ask around. In terms of sort of preparing or considering whether you would like to apply, I think while, you know, folks weren't necessarily familiar with the fellowship itself, you obviously always have people who could help, you know, reviewing essays, talking to you about when you're thinking about drafting a personal statement. It's so important for that statement to really reflect who you are and why you're doing this and why you think you would be a good fit. So even having people you can brainstorm with and sort of, you know, flesh that out to kind of have put out a concrete narrative that really tells your story to folks who are reviewing the applications, I think is critical. So whether that's a teacher, whether that's a fellow student, whether that's a friend, whether that's your mom, you know, I think just knowing that you're not alone and kind of thinking about your resources for really developing a competitive application package. And then beyond that, obviously there are sort of oral interview aspects of it. So I think just practicing, you know, we have lots of great students who are excellent at many things, but you'd be surprised at how, you know, being in a room, you know, with panelists can maybe be a bit intimidating. So just practice your answers. Sometimes just even getting stumped by the question of like, okay, why would you like to join the Foreign Service, right? It's a big question. So just sort of think about your answer, you know, and then beyond that, as you go through the phases of the process, I think just having open channels of communication with folks who are supporting you along the way to kind of think of steps that you might be missing or what you should be preparing for are critical. So those would be some top pieces of advice I would offer for folks looking at navigating the actual application process.
Thank you. I think that's great words of advice because I know as a DIR, when I'm out talking with students, they always ask me, how can I make myself more competitive in the application process? Or how do I actually go about doing this, you know, getting being successful in that? So that's really important to hear. DCM, we're going to go back to you because we lost you at Be Passionate. I have written down the first four or five and we all want to hear the fifth one. I thought it was great advice. So I'm assuming you're back on and I'd love to swing back to you.
Try not to be passionate and get frozen with like the ugliest face possible. Like always have a face that could be frozen elegantly. No. The fifth thing, I was actually going to give all my props and hail to Anna because it's develop your executive presence. particularly as women. There are men who also have to work on this, but maybe, I don't know, I know that this is not in order, but I was going to let Anna say a little bit, because she's worked so hard on the issue of executive presence for women in the State Department. So I think that is a very important part in a career. So maybe can I just ask, or maybe after Rachel, that Anna says just a few words, because she's a master at that.
That would be great. Yes, please. And thank you.
So should I just jump in, or?
Absolutely. Yes, we all want to hear.
Okay. So I got into the topic of executive presence, turning a very difficult moment into an opportunity. Essentially, I had a very difficult experience at a meeting of being interrupted multiple times by the senior official who I was briefing, and actually having other colleagues jump in on the behavior, and just really going back to my office and smarting from that and thinking, how can I turn this into both an opportunity for myself so that this doesn't happen to me again, and then also support other people to whom who witnessed what happened, right, or to whom this might have happened as well. And so I applied for this fellowship, of which actually Stephanie is an alum as well, which supports women leaders rising up the ranks, seeking to strive for executive positions. And I spent a year studying executive presence, which is this, we do get training on executive presence, but only when you reach the point where you're in a DCM principal officers course, which in my humble opinion, we should actually be talking about this, you know, as Stephanie notes, early on, or you know, right away, even when you're thinking about joining an organization such as the State Department. But it's sort of this notion of there are certain elements, what we call things like gravitas, your composure under fire, your ability to answer questions when you're briefing multiple questions deep without being defensive or sort of getting flustered. How you appear, your appearance, which is a critical first filter, whether in person or on screen, how you act and how you inspire confidence in the people who are sitting at the table with you, and frankly among your teams as well, that you have the ability to lead them and to guide them, sort of your presence and how you show up. All of those things combined can really make the difference between someone who may be smart and know their job, but may or may not be getting passed over for promotions or opportunities or positions of greater responsibility. And frankly, it's critically important, especially when you don't necessarily look like what people have in their mind when they think of who is a leader or who is the boss. It's even more critically important. So just in a nutshell, that is executive presence. It is something that can be worked on and developed, and it's critically important to have people who will give you feedback about your executive presence, and also important to support others who are working on their executive presence. And another piece I think of executive presence that's important is in advance of meetings, really preparing your information and your points. And if it's a controversial issue that you're advocating for, try to connect with others in advance of the meeting to sort of build those alliances around what you're advocating for, in order to avoid situations kind of like what I experienced of what happened with me at the table. And sort of all of these lessons learned I gleaned from a year of reading, looking at articles, and speaking to people whose executive presence I admired. And so also important to look at executive presence role models. One of those people was Stephanie, actually. Executive presence role models who you really want to learn from. And I'll pause there.
Thank you. Actually, I think that's such an important point about executive presence. And one of the reasons we're doing this panel, right, is to talk about these skills that you three as senior leaders have been able to develop and then to share with others who are interested in joining. So thank you for sharing that. That's very important. Okay, I want to turn to Das Arndt real quickly. Looking back at your career, I can see that you've taken on management positions throughout the State Department, and each role seems to increase responsibility over resources and people. So can you share what skills were important that you entered with, and then kind of how you gained key management skills along your career? And maybe even, because you've alluded to this before, how our audience can better understand what a civil service management position would actually entail. And I know that's a lot.
It's a tall order, so let me see if I can try here. So first, again, I came in as a entry-level analysts. I don't even think they bring people in as GS5s anymore. I think that that shows how old I am. But as an analyst, right within that word, the ability to analyze was so important. And I think a lot of people kind of miss that when they're coming out of college and they've done papers and they've done research, and they kind of sort of forget that that's also what people are might be asking you here. Whether for me it was looking at numbers for budgets, looking at trends, gaps, identifying those kind of things, putting all those pieces together, and kind of a little bit what Anna was saying, putting that story together. And while I was working with a lot of numbers, then I was very fortunate at the beginning of my career. I had great opportunities, really scary opportunities, to be briefing assistant secretaries as like a GS7 or a GS9. And, you know, and was I great at it? Not to begin with, I can tell you, but one of the things was, and I think Anna mentioned this also, is know your brief. Like, I had to know what I was talking about. I had to know what I didn't know. And being able to distinguish that and allow the conversation to go places. One of the things about the humility statement that was made, and I think maybe that was Stephanie, a lot of times you're gonna go in and brief those bosses, your superiors, and they may or may not take your recommendation. And if they don't take your recommendation, that's totally fine. And you're gonna figure out in your mind how you're gonna get behind them and support them to do what they wanna do. I always said if it's not illegal or immoral, I'm gonna be able to handle that. And my recommendations weren't taken all the time. A lot of times they were, but I would say analysis has been part of it. As going up the chain, going up the ladder, I'm still analyzing things. I'm still looking at gaps. I'm still finding trends, but now it's in a little bit more strategic way. So I would say the ability to, you know, envision the future, strategize for the future, think where you want to take your team, how do you want the team to be able to work in the future. Here I've got a little phrase as a future of passport services. How do we get from here to what it's going to look like when I've retired and can't spell passport anymore? And that's where the vision and the strategy, I think, are kind of skill sets that people need. I've had an opportunity to work with OPM, the Office of Personnel Management, on many, many SES, Senior Executive Service panels, where they're looking at people who are trying to enter the senior executive service. And you have to have your executive core qualifications approved by OPM before you can enter into the, you know, be certified to be a SES. And one of the areas that I have found, whether it's for an IT professional or an administrative type of position, a legal position, I've served on lots of panels, is the business acumen part of it is really challenging for people. And, you know, being on the resource management, I've had a little bit more, you know, that's basically what the background was in. But even for some of the foreign service officers, might be political officers or econ officers, consular officers, at some point you're going to manage people and money, you're going to have facilities, crisis management. There's a lot of management opportunities out there and requirements as you move up the chain. So for me, I think just being not afraid to delve into areas that you are not familiar with. And I think that goes back to the curiosity is absolutely a key to that. Always being willing to learn something new, try something new, not being scared of not always knowing the answers, being able to say, I don't know, let me go back and find out and get back to you on that. But I really think so, analysis, budget planning, strategic visioning, you know, and just that curiosity and wanting to learn, I think are some of the things that have been with me throughout my career. Thank you.
Thank you. And I heard all three of you talk about, you know, similar ideas, be curious for one, but also continuing to develop your skill sets throughout your career, and also the humility aspect of it. Those three have jumped out as well. So I now, because you've each alluded to it, and CG Eskrahima, you actually mentioned it, but I do want to talk a little bit about challenges. I think it's important as we're having this discussion that we can be as candid as possible with all of the women on this call who are looking towards a possible career in the State Department. So I want you to each, if possible, reflect on an important success you have had, and then I want you to follow that up with a challenge you have faced, if that's possible. And I will let DCM Sibtagram go first.
So I love this question. And I will say, because they sent it to us beforehand in case you guys thought that we came so like brilliant just on our own. But my greatest success, I have to say, are my daughters. I have two daughters. I have a senior at Northwestern who's about to graduate and a sophomore at Pepperdine. And I just look at them and I'm so grateful to God that they have lived this life. We've lived in Mali, we've lived in Tunisia, we've lived in Mexico, we've lived in Singapore, and they are brilliant, smart, successful women. And I feel like that's my greatest success. And it's very interesting because I have been blessed with a great career and I have done wonderful things professionally, but there's nothing that brings me the joy that my children bring to me. So I do feel like when I was asked this question, I'm like, oh yeah, my daughters are my greatest success. I am happy to speak about foreign policy successes, but I have to say personally when I think about it. But then similarly, my greatest challenge has been my family. and I will say that because I know a lot of women look at joining the Foreign Service and men today also who have spouses that need to have careers. And so having a 31-year career in the State Department and the military, we move all the time. And I will just give this one specific example. I was the DCM in Bamako, Mali, and it was such a brilliant moment in my career. I had been the public affairs officer there before. I came back as the DCM for an ambassador that I loved. Mali was going through a very difficult time, so I was professionally fulfilling to be there, trying to work out how to assist the country, how to take care of our people. But then they had to evacuate all our families, and they evacuated my husband and my daughters. And so I stayed 6 months more, and then I made the very difficult professional decision to curtail from this amazing opportunity. It was my first DCM job. And when I curtailed, I was looking around, and for people who don't know the Foreign Service, so they're different, you know, levels of leadership in an embassy. And the job I took was here in Mission, Mexico, actually as the cultural affairs officer, which for my colleagues who know the State Department, that's a very strange job to go from a DCM to being a cultural affairs officer. But I did it because it was the right thing for my family. And as it turned out, I ended up being the Minister Counselor for Public Diplomacy here. I won the award that was mentioned. And I really was able to learn so much being here that it allowed me to go be the DCM in Singapore and now come back as the DCM here. So my point is we make hard choices when you have family and other issues. But again, I think if you can bring the other qualities that I tried to mention to you all, whatever you're doing, just be amazing at it and things will open up. And I think I'm religious. I think God put you, it might be fate, destiny. But so my biggest success is my family, and my biggest challenge has been my family too, making sure that they're happy as I try to serve my country.
Thank you for that answer. I'll say, you know, when we're out in the field talking to people who are interested in this career, that question always comes up. How do I balance, you know, the demands to move overseas and also have my family at the same time? And I always tell people, you know, you got to go into this with your eyes wide open. It's an amazing career, but there are challenges that come. So thank you for talking about that and also telling us, you know, your greatest success is your children as well. CG Eskrahima, if you could go next.
I think my greatest challenge has been working to maintain my connections to my home, my roots, you know, the causes that I grew up really, the domestic, you know, local causes that I grew up, you know, really, really caring about. And as I continued on in my career, I found really creative ways to sort of marry those worlds, whether by bringing, you know, speakers to posts that I've been to, you know, that, for example, in Montreal, we had this amazing Latina author from, you know, Brooklyn, who's written this book that kind of evokes different issues in the Latino community. And it was, you know, as part of a celebration of US and Canadian Latin American History Month. And so I think, you know, as Stephanie alluded to, sometimes your greatest challenges can also be your greatest opportunities, right? Because the reason why we try to recruit such a diverse, you know, State Department workforce is to bring those, you know, diverse perspectives to the table and tell America's story in as fulsome a way as possible. I also want to drill down on the piece about, you know, when you make sacrifices in what you perceive as career sacrifices for families can actually also turn into interesting opportunities, and to just kind of go with it. I'm a new mom. My son is about to be a year old, and kind of taking on this journey into motherhood sort of later on in my career. I mean, I applied for sort of senior leadership jobs 7 months pregnant, just kind of being like, hey, I'm just trying this out. I don't know how this is all going to work out, but I'm just going to go for it. And incredibly, you know, it's all worked out really well, sort of having, you know, getting married and having a really supportive husband, all sort of later on in my career, just sort of going for it and then kind of figuring out those pieces as you go along. Some of the choices that I made to accommodate those life moments have actually ended up being career advancing, even though I didn't know that it would be at the time. So I do try to share with people who, you know, ask whether they can balance it all, like, to really do try to have some measure of faith that it will work out, although it may not seem like that at the time.
Okay, first of all, congratulations. That's wonderful. Second of all, thanks for sharing that, because, you know, it is something we're hearing quite often. So I think it's really important for people to be part of this conversation. Okay, Des, Arne, can I turn to you?
I completely echo the remarks about your children are your greatest success and your greatest challenge. And they just have bigger problems the older they get, I have to say. So they're never a dull moment as a parent. And I think that, you know, that is a challenge of being a parent. And I hear a lot of people trying to say, well, how do you find work-life balance as if it's going to be a thing every day? And sometimes it's work and sometimes it's life, whatever that is for people. And it's not going to be equal every day. And I think that's just one thing going into it, that it is a challenge, but sometimes you just have to focus where you have to focus. And for me, I look back and I just don't know how I did some things and thank God I was young, because like I got my master's degree while I was working full time and, you know, in the central budget office of the State Department. It's not a 40 hour a week job by any means. And also had my first two kids while I was doing that. So it took me 4 years, but I look back at that and I'm still very proud of myself. And I think maybe I was just numb. I didn't realize what I was doing to myself at the time. But you know, I look back at that with a great deal of pride that I was able to do that. And I know a lot of people are taking on larger than life activities. And you know, I think the other thing is just looking at it, and you've got the benefit of time to go back and say it was okay, right? So when you're in the moment, sometimes the challenges seem a little bit too much, too intense, and to be able to step back and say it's a long game and this will work out, it's okay. I just want to say that to everybody. You know, I had those kids, and then my last child had personal medical issues. I actually resigned from the department. I don't know, that's not in my bio. When I was working as the contractor in the IT world, that was because it was a stopgap. And I ended up coming back to the department. I missed my positions here. But you know, it was for personal reasons, and to put my family first and the requirements there, that was a big challenge. But you know what? I had created so many connections that people were seeking me out to say, you know, we know that you can do this, come do this part-time for us or come do this. So I think no matter what the challenges that anybody has, it's not as bad as you think. And the successes are there and they build up. I've done so many wonderful things. I can't even think of them right now. So, everybody just needs to just put their best foot forward every day. And I tell my staff here that opportunities often come disguised as work. And, you know, if you just come in every day is another day to excel, right? So you just come in and face whatever challenge that is and ask for help when you need it. That's all I'm going to say. There are people out there who can support you.
I think that's also important for people to hear. And then to play the long game, right? That there are a lot of, things in your career that are going to go different directions and you can have a career.
Hey, did he leave yet? Okay. I figured as much.
I hear somebody has their, I'm going to mute them. Okay. Okay, so I actually have more questions, but I realize time-wise we're starting to get short, and I see there are so many questions in the chat that all of our audience has. So I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask Michelle, since she's been monitoring the chat this entire time, if she could go ahead and kind of tell us maybe one of the questions that has been asked the most or kind of bubbled up to the top that you can give to our panelists.
Hey, thank you all so much. It's been so fascinating to listen to. We've had a lot of questions in the chat, lots of personal narratives or wanting to know more about their individual case, but to try and extract it and make it relevant to as many people here as possible. One question we just received from Emily is, any advice you all have for someone who doesn't come from an international relations major, or maybe coming from the private sector or from something outside the field of political science, how can they get involved? Thank you.
And feel free to jump in, whoever wants to take that question.
I'll just start super quickly. The United States foreign policy is so vast that we need all kinds of experts at the table. And I know even in Ciudad Juarez, I have an environmental scientist who's now on the consular line. And so we need brilliant people from all walks of life in the United States to try to join the Foreign Service. Now, I will let your DIRs talk about what you need to know to pass the exam, right? It's been too long since I've taken it to tell you that. But what I will say is that we need you and there's a place for you. And the only thing that I would warn is that know that you're coming into the Foreign Service in the State Department to work on foreign policy. So I think, you can say, I want to come be an environmental scientist in the Foreign Service or at the State Department. No, you're coming here to do foreign affairs and diplomacy. But that said, I absolutely think that we need all of everybody's specialty. We also have a whole wide range of specialists that bring specific skills to the Foreign Service. So we just need everyone to really represent America and to be great at foreign policy. So please don't be discouraged.
If I could just do another plug for civil service. I mean, I say the Department of State's like a small town. We've got doctors and lawyers and, people who do GIS and people who do data analysis and finance people and human resources people and architects and engineers. And just, I can't even think of all the jobs that there are at the State Department. And so there's opportunities really for across the board. And I wouldn't limit it, even if you don't have a major that sounds like it would be good for a job. I think some of those basic skill sets that we were talking about are transferable among positions too. So oceans, environment, and science, there is a bureau for oceans, environment, and science. So if somebody was an environmental engineer, I think you mentioned, there are homes for you in the civil service also.
CGS Krohima, do you want to say anything or should we move on to the next question I allude to? Okay. And I'll just say thank you guys for saying that because, we're on the front lines right now in recruiting the DIRs and we're definitely telling people we want all skill sets, right? We want you to study various things. We're really focused on STEM right now, bringing in people with STEM backgrounds, looking at where our policy is going. So I think it's important for people on the call to realize that we are looking for people with a diversity of backgrounds, not just a background in international relations. Michelle, I'm going to turn it over to you because these questions are coming in fast and furious. Can you tell us another one?
Sure. I have the lucky job to pick some of the ones I find really interesting. So someone, Gil, asked, are there any do's and don'ts that you as diplomats, foreign service and civil servants should do and should not do in your first 3 months of employment? And what was your most challenging assignment and how did you handle it? Thanks. Thanks, Gil.
I might jump in and say, do read the room. When you are considering what to brief or, you know, what to share or, you know, how you engage, it's important to pick up the cues of the meeting and what's being discussed and your role in the meeting. I think that's probably one of the most important pieces of advice I would offer to someone early on, because the State Department is a particular culture. In fact, we may have many cultures within the broader State Department culture. So I think it's just important to read the room, do assume good intent. You know, as you're sort of making your way and figuring out the ins and outs of our bureaucracy, do ask questions. I think we are, you will find that the State Department is a very, I think, generous environment toward our interns who are sort of learning and also toward our entry-level employees. We're sort of geared to support folks who are learning about our organization. So those would be my do's. Maybe leave it to others to add other do's and add their don'ts.
Do either of you want to jump in? Go ahead.
I would just add to that. I was in a panel yesterday in a course with one of my colleagues here in the Bureau of Consular Affairs. And her advice, I'm going to steal it, is to be kind. So do be kind to people. I think it gets back to some, you know, assuming good intent. The one thing about the Foreign Service, you guys all move around and you all come back and everybody knows everybody, but you never know who's going to know everybody in which place and where you're going to be. And you never know. So always do your best with the person and take the time to help the person that's in front of you. And I think that's going to be, I don't know if I have any don'ts, so I'll stick with the do.
Okay.
I'd just add that the basic advice for everyone in your first 3 months of anything, just listen a lot and learn and pay attention and, you know, and just give yourself a minute to get adjusted and be kind on yourself. I totally agree with Rachel, be kind to others, be kind to yourself. And just know in the first 3 months, you're just a sponge, you're learning it all, and that you're going to be great because you're going to learn and then you're going to be part of it. But don't expect, don't put it on yourself like day one, you have to be like in there fixing things and showing, you know, why you're there. Just take a minute and just soak it all in. That's what I'd say.
Yeah, I think those are all great pieces of advice. I just saw a question from Skylar that I'll ask. How have you seen changes within foreign affairs or the State Department since you joined? It says, especially as being a woman in the field. And do you think it's improving? It's becoming more inclusive? Just some of your thoughts on that, if either or any of you want to take that.
Start, but I definitely, Anna and Rachel, I mean, because I've been at this 31 years. I was very fortunate. I will say, as soon as I came in, I've had great women bosses, which I know that wasn't the case for a lot of women starting out. I personally was very lucky. I do say we have come a long way, particularly in this administration has done a lot to make things better, not only for women, but for our organization as a whole, you know, more flexibilities, more understanding, more, you know, parental care, more, you know, just everything has gotten better in my view. Do we have a way to go? Yes, but I see more women in leadership. I see more women. I mean, I have whole sections that are mostly women now, which was never the case when I joined. So things definitely have gotten better, and the department has worked really hard, and people like, I know Rachel and Anna have helped us get us there.
I would add that I think the conversations are out there more often, and that the men are also starting to join the conversation and realizing that they have a role to play to, as I say, make the world better for my daughter and my granddaughter and those who come after us. So I think that's a really key piece, is having the men at the table having the discussions with us about how to make it better.
Okay, I just realized we are actually out of time. So before I finish, I just want to give you each 30 seconds to a minute, if you want, just to kind of say one last piece of advice or anything that we missed in this panel. I know we have a lot of questions that are still coming in fast and furious, and we're trying to answer them. But I just want to give you guys the opportunity. So I am going to start with CG Escrohima.
I would say, as I at the top, that you'll remember I began this journey when I was 19 years old, and at the time I didn't know, I like to joke and say I didn't know any better, you know, I didn't exactly know what I was sort of getting myself into, and I didn't know what all the options were out there. And in a way, it's kind of a good thing, because I feel like you all, there's so much information overload out there, you can almost see it and imagine it, because you can see so many aspects of the State Department, you know, or of this career, in whether it's in social media or what you hear out there. And I would just say that I if I had it to do all over again, I would. And I know that the process may seem long and daunting, but to get in or to apply for fellowships, but it is worth it. If you don't make it, you know, in your first go around, try and try again. There are so many more, you know, I was reflecting on your question about what's different. And I would say there are many, so we're trying so much harder to reach out to populations all across the United States and to diverse populations, that there really is a hand extended to you if you are interested in learning more about us or joining this organization in ways that just weren't the case, 25 years ago, as it were. I mean, there were always efforts, but now it's just sort of so widespread. And I think these virtual platforms also help support those efforts. So I would just really make a plug and say that, you know, I was 19 a long time ago, you know, but I definitely, I'm happy that, I want to thank my 19-year-old self for, you know, taking this plunge.
Okay. Thank you. Not that long ago, but I think that's great advice. Okay. I will turn it over to Des Arndt.
Yeah, sure. I do a lot of executive interviews with people who are in the leadership programs. A lot of the staff who work for me are in some of the leadership programs at various levels. And a lot of times they'll say, well, what was the secret? How did you get ahead? How did you move up in the ranks so fast? And one time I was saying, I just need some help on how to answer that question, because I really feel like I want to help somebody, but there is no secret. Because back to the thing, we're all individuals and we all have our own life journey and approach. And so I have this piece of paper that a staff member gave me many years ago with a quote from Oprah Winfrey. And this is what I used to tell people now. The big secret in life is that there is no big secret. Whatever your goal, you can get there if you're willing to work. And I think Oprah Winfrey was pretty much willing to work at it. So there's always opportunities. There's always a future. And you can get there if you keep trying.
Thank you. That's important for everyone to hear. Okay, DCM Siptak Ramnath, I'm going to turn it over to you.
So I want everybody on this call to find what they're passionate about, right? But what I also want you to know is life's too short to be unhappy. And we spend way too much time at work to be unhappy at work. So even if where you are right now is not your perfect bliss, be amazing at it. Right? Come in every day bringing all of your skills and all of your love and all of your joy to it, because doing that is going to open up doors that you may not have thought were going to be there. So don't ever just feel stuck where you are. Wherever you are, go in, be amazing, bring that joy and that energy, and it will open doors for you to the next thing if this is not your thing. So that's what I would say, is just wake up every morning and, you know, like my mom said, if you're going to do it well. So that's what I'd leave it. A shout out to my mom.
A great way to end.
Thank you to our Dipson residents. I don't even know how you're managing all of this. This is incredible that this is what you all are able to do and answer all the questions. And to our sign language interpreter, thank you. There's just so much excellence, amazingness going on here. So thank you to all of you.
Thank you for saying that. And I just want to thank all of you for your great wisdom that you left us with at the end. I literally couldn't have said it better. I was going to try to summarize it, but there's no point because you guys have done it. And I really want to thank Consul General Escrohima, Deputy Assistant Secretary Arndt, and Deputy Chief of Mission Siptak Ramnath. I purposely said those words instead of using acronyms in case anyone didn't know what it was all along. We've gotten amazing feedback as well from people. So thank you to everyone for listening. I learned a tremendous amount from this panel, and I'm sure everyone else did as well. So thank you. And everyone, enjoy your night or your evening, or sorry, your afternoon, depending on where you are. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.